Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Spider's Web, a police procedural novel, by Mike Omer, narrated by Eric Martin. Chapter 1. When Kendall selected the songs for her jogging playlist, she didn't pause to think, "What if I die hearing this?" It wasn't a question that normally occurred to her, though perhaps on that day it should have. She thought Taylor Swift's Shake It Off would be a fun song to jog with. It played as she ran through the park toward a thick cluster of trees. The park was mostly empty this early in the morning. Thin mist hovered above the grass, covering the ground in a forlorn gray blanket. A long, paved path circled the park, twisting around Buttermere Pond, and then led into a small grove. This was the path Kendall now followed on her early morning jog, listening to Taylor Swift, thinking about her growing clientele and income. By the time she reached the artificial pond in the middle of the park, she had broken a sweat. The chilly morning breeze was pleasantly cool on her skin. She watched the calm, dark water as she ran, noticing the way the trees reflected in it, warped into strange shapes. She was cautiously happy. Kendall treated happiness like a toddler learning to walk. She approached it gently, taking careful, tentative steps. She didn't want to rush into happiness. That was how you got hurt. She didn't want to get hurt again. What she loved most about her new life was the complete control. She had control over herself, over her financial situation, over her schedule. She had complete control over the people in her life. She kept those to a bare minimum. She rounded a corner, following the path as it moved closer to the pond, when something exploded against her right temple. Her vision darkened for a moment, and then she could see again. Everything seemed fuzzy. She was on her knees, one hand on the ground and one hand against her head, trying to understand what had just happened. Taylor Swift was singing about haters. Someone grabbed her arm, twisting it behind her back. She screamed as he pulled her to her feet. She tried to look backwards, but turning her head was hard, and the world was an unfocused blur. Her attacker shoved her forward, and she stumbled, nearly fell, the person behind her holding her up by her twisted arm. It felt as if he was about to rip it out of its socket. She cried in pain, begged him to stop, whoever it was. She tried to make sense of things. Who was it? What did he want from her? She realized where he was taking her, and she struggled, trying to twist away. Something, a rough hand, smacked her on the back of her head. She knew it was a hand. She knew how it felt being beaten. But it wasn't supposed to happen anymore. Not here. Two more steps, and she felt the cold against her legs. Her attacker forced her into the pond, the water's surface a blurry thing, sparkling in the early sun. Her eyesight slowly focused, and she realized that, in the background, Taylor Swift was still singing, telling her to shake it off. And then another sharp pain, her arm twisted even higher. She screamed again, tears filling her eyes. She was forced to bend forward, stumbling to her knees, the water lapping against her, drenching her shorts. She babbled, pleading. She didn't know what was happening, couldn't see her attacker, who never let up, pulling harder and harder, and she felt dizzy, nauseated, about to faint. And then everything was cold. She inhaled in shock, and her mouth and throat filled with water. A hand held her head under. She panicked, twisting, not caring about the pain in her arm anymore, just trying to breathe. Spots danced around her field of view as it darkened, the muddy waters swirling cloud patterns growing dimmer. The hand was relentless, crushing her head against the pond's sandy bottom, wet sand clogging her nose, brushing against her teeth, and still the music played. It was getting dark, her mind foggy, and her lungs exploding with pain. She had just one reflex left, telling her she had to break through, screaming that she had to get away, had to breathe. But she was weak and helpless, and she couldn't. Detective Mitchell Lonnie walked down the paved path that snaked through the park, approaching the crime scene. The rain pattered around him, a light drizzle, but enough to make him regret his decision to leave the umbrella at home. He hunched his shoulders and pulled the collar of his jacket closer as the raindrops crawled down his neck. The sky was gray, matching his mood as he thought of Pauline's face when he told her that he'd gotten a call, that they would have to cancel their plans for lunch. She'd had that spark in her eyes, the kind she had when she knew she shouldn't be angry, but was anyway. They hardly had any time together lately, and though people could be murdered any time, she would have appreciated it if they wouldn't do so on a weekend. Candace, the dispatcher, had told him on the phone that a body had been found buried near Buttermere Pond. He could see the crime scene now. Several people were already there, near the path by the grove of trees. He'd already seen his partner's car parked in the parking lot next to the patrol car that had originally been dispatched to the scene. It was a good thing it was raining. On a sunny August weekend, the park would have been full of people, and they'd have had to handle the gaggle of onlookers that would invariably flock to the scene. As things stood, the park was empty, and the scene held only six people, and he recognized almost all of them. He stopped for a moment, trying to take in the entire scene. Kate and Noel, the patrol officers, were talking to a young, scared-looking Hispanic teenager. He wore a yellow raincoat and a backpack, and clutched the leash of a wet golden retriever. The two crime scene investigators, Matt Lowry and Violet Todd, were hunched by a shallow hole. Matt dug carefully with a small shovel, while Violet took pictures with a small camera. Next to them stood Mitchell's partner, Detective Jacob Cooper, wearing his iconic fedora over his completely bald head and holding a black umbrella. He was a wide-shouldered man, his presence authoritative and imposing. His eyes were icy blue, always alert, and missed nothing. He'd spent the last 25 years on the force, and was one of the sharpest detectives ever to work for the Glenmore Park Detective Squad. Mitchell approached Jacob, who shook his hand. "What do we have?" Mitchell asked. "The kid's dog found the body," Jacob said, indicating the teenager. "It was buried about 2 feet deep. He called us as soon as he realized what it was." "He just happened to be walking in the park on a rainy day?" Mitchell asked. Jacob shrugged. "I haven't talked to him yet," he said. Mitchell approached the grave. It was only partially uncovered, with the body's feet and head visible, and the rest of the body still buried. Matt, his dark-skinned neck glistening in the rain, slowly scratched away the soil, careful not to disrupt the evidence in any way. Kneeling, he looked even shorter than usual. Matt was one of the shortest people Mitchell knew, and his surname, Lowry, had probably caused him infinite grief over the years. The air was rank with the smell of rot and death, and Mitchell found himself taking quick, short breaths through his mouth. The body was far from fresh. The blackened, glistening skin made Mitchell's stomach turn. It was, as far as he could tell, a woman, her eyes and tongue protruding gruesomely. Her hair was partially detached from her scalp. He took a step back, an involuntary gasp escaping his mouth. "Watch your step," Matt said, without turning around. Mitchell looked at the ground by his feet. A splash of yellow sludge was only inches from his left foot. "What is that?" he asked in a muffled voice, holding his wet shirt to his mouth and nose. "A partially digested breakfast, contributed by the kid who found the body," Matt answered. Vomit stood to reason. A few feet from the puddle of vomit was another splash. "That one as well?" Mitchell asked, pointing. "That one belongs to Noel," Matt said. "Right," Mitchell said, and considered adding his own contribution to the lot. His empty stomach was rebelling against the whole thing. There was a pile of evidence bags by Matt's feet, most holding dirt. Next to them were several containers in which Mitchell spotted some insects crawling. "How long do you think you'll be here?" Mitchell asked. "Well," Matt said, "I'll uncover the body and take some additional insect and soil samples. I'll scan the surrounding area, but I wouldn't hold my breath for any evidence I find here. Hundreds of people walk here every day, and this isn't a fresh crime. Any idea how long ago? Mitchell asked. Just an approximation? No, Matt said shortly. Yeah, okay, Mitchell said. He walked away to join Jacob, who was approaching Noel and the teenager. Noel nodded at Mitchell and Jacob, his eyes serious. Mitchell liked Noel. He was a solid cop, and never showed any of the resentment some of the other patrol cops displayed toward detectives. I'm Detective Jacob Cooper, Jacob told the kid. This is my partner, Detective Mitchell Lonnie. What's your name?
Daniel Hernandez, the kid said.
His light brown face was wet from the rain, his black hair flat on his head. His eyes were a bit red, and Mitchell suspected he had cried earlier. His golden retriever sat on the ground, glumly, its head on its front paws, its fur a soggy mess. Can you please tell us how you found this body?
It was my dog that found it, Daniel said. Not me.
Did you pick up anything or touch anything before or after you found the body? Jacob asked, narrowing his eyes.
No, I mean, maybe I touched some things, but not the body, I think. I might have touched it once, accidentally. I'm sorry.
The boy began sobbing again, his eyes on the ground. Mitchell knelt by the boy and touched his arm gently. Daniel lifted his gaze and met Mitchell's compassionate stare. Mitchell saw the boy's shoulders sag as he relaxed a bit, identifying a perceived friend. It was a cheap trick. Both detectives knew well that people reflexively liked Mitchell. Jacob would establish the role of the hard, no-nonsense detective, and then Mitchell would swoop in and earn their trust, though probably in this case it was hardly needed. This was just a kid who was in the wrong place at the wrong time. Don't worry, Daniel, Mitchell said, his voice soft. You did nothing wrong. Daniel nodded, sniffling. How did your dog find the body? Mitchell asked.
She's like a stench magnet. If there's anything rotting or stinking within a mile, she immediately homes in on it. She likes to roll in dead animals.
I see, Mitchell said, queasy at the thought. So she smelled it?
I guess, Daniel said, looking at the dog in irritation. She pulled me over there and started digging. I let her dig. I was just messaging with my girl, so I didn't really mind stopping for a bit. But then I noticed something in the ground. It was the head. I called the police right away.
Do you live nearby, Daniel? Mitchell asked.
Yeah, I mean, about 15 minutes from the park.
Do you often come here to walk your dog?
Sometimes, on weekends, Daniel said, shrugging.
Even when it rains?
Dog's got to do what a dog's got to do.
Okay, so you found the body and called us. What did you do then?
Nothing. I just waited. Cops got here about 20 minutes later.
Did you see anything unusual while you were waiting?
No.
Did anyone go by?
No.
Okay, thanks, Daniel. Can I go?
Sure, Jacob said. Just give us your details so we can contact you if we need anything.
Daniel gave them his address and phone number and turned to leave.
Hang on, Mitchell said.
What?
Give me your phone for a second, Daniel.
Why?
Just do it.
Glumly, Daniel handed Mitchell the phone. Mitchell opened the picture gallery and looked at the most recent pictures. He sighed. The last three images were selfies that Daniel had taken, the head of the uncovered body prominent in the background. Mitchell showed the images to Jacob, who shook his head.
Daniel, a selfie with a dead body? Seriously? Jacob said.
I was just gonna...
No, Mitchell said.
You weren't. He deleted the images.
Did you share these images? Jacob asked.
No.
Are you sure? We'll check.
No, I didn't share them with anyone.
Okay. Mitchell handed the phone back to Daniel.
Look, Daniel said. Can I take a selfie with one of you then? I just want something to show my friends.
Sure, Jacob said. Take a picture with Detective Lonnie.
Mitchell sent Jacob a scathing look, but Daniel was already happily edging next to Mitchell, tapping his phone.
He slung his arm around Mitchell's neck as if they were long-lost friends and took some photos, all the while trying to make Mitchell act a bit more detective-y. Finally, to Mitchell's relief, Daniel left, the dog plodding after him. Mitchell approached Violet, who was pacing around the scene now, examining the ground carefully. "Found anything interesting yet?" he asked. "A used condom," she said, raising her eyes to meet his, "and 2 beer bottles." Mitchell made a mental note of the condom and wondered briefly if this was a sex crime. He turned around and looked at the grave again. Matt still knelt next to it, his face grim, patiently scraping the dirt off the body. He turned toward Jacob. "Strange place to hide a body," he said.
"Yeah," Jacob said. "This area is usually full of people."
He stared into the distance, and Mitchell followed his eyes. 3 figures drew nearer, 2 men carrying a stretcher and a woman by their side. "Assuming the killer came here with the body," Mitchell said, "he'd have to carry it all the way over to the grove, dig a hole in the ground, dump it, and cover it without anyone noticing."
"And why would he even do that?" Jacob answered. "There are 1 million better places and ways to get rid of a body."
The 3 figures were close now. Mitchell recognized Annie Turner, her red hair completely soaked. "Hello, detectives," Annie said as she reached them. Annie was Glenmore Park's medical examiner. She was easy to work with and did her best to explain any medical findings until even the thickest of detectives could follow what she said. She wore a yellow raincoat over her white pants and shirt. The square eyeglasses she always wore were spattered with raindrops, and Mitchell wondered if she could really see anything through them. He showed her the way to the grave. Matt had removed most of the soil from the body's torso. Tatters of what had probably once been a sports bra covered very little of the woman's decaying flesh. Despite his 9 years on the force, Mitchell found the sight distressing and averted his eyes, looking at Annie instead. She approached the grave hesitantly, her steps small and careful.
Hello, Matt," she said.
Matt cleared his throat.
"Hello, Annie," he said.
Annie crouched next to the body and looked at it intently.
"I see you already bagged her hands," she said softly.
"Well, yes," Matt said. "Do you want me to wait for you next time? I can definitely do that. You're right, I should have waited."
"No, no, it's okay. No need to wait. You did what you were supposed to."
Annie's voice became a bit choked. Mitchell stared at them both, his eyebrows raised. It was like watching 2 teenagers try to gather the courage to ask each other to the prom what was up with them.
"You didn't have to come," Matt said. "I mean, it's not like you had to pronounce the death here, right? You're just getting wet." "No, it's okay. I wanted to see the body."
Annie bent to touch one of the body's hands just as Matt cleaned some dirt off it. Their fingers touched, and they both withdrew quickly.
"I'll be done in a minute," Matt blurted.
"Right, right."
Annie stood up and turned to the 2 men who accompanied her.
"Let's open the stretcher," she said. "Matt will be done soon."
Mitchell circled the grave, then turned to Jacob once more.
"Looks like she was wearing running clothes," he said. "So she was probably jogging," Jacob said.
"Probably.
She went jogging in the park, and the killer waited for her here.
I'm guessing it was very early in the morning or late in the evening," Mitchell said. "There weren't many people in the park."
"And after she was killed, he buried her in the same spot," Jacob said.
"Right." They stayed on the scene while Annie collected the body, placing it in a black body bag. Matt bagged a car key found in the body's back pocket and gathered some additional samples. The 2 detectives and 2 crime scene technicians canvassed the crime scene. In addition to the beer bottles and the condom, they found an old dry pen, a cigarette stub, and a candy bar wrap, all within 50 feet of the grave. There was no ID on the body. There was no reason to rush the investigation. The crime wasn't fresh. Annie had quickly determined it was committed at least a week before, and there was no easy way to identify the body, no family to notify. In short, there was no excuse for paid overtime. The chief was quick to inform Captain Bailey that his squad could wait and start working the case on Monday. Unsurprisingly, no one argued. What was left of the weekend passed uneventfully. Though they had seen the dead, buried, decaying body, the detectives and the crime scene crew refused to let the incident mar their weekend plans. But death can trickle in during quiet, thoughtful moments. It doesn't ask for permission, often sneaking into people's minds before they notice it is there. During Saturday dinner, Jacob's daughter Amy asked him to pass the salad bowl. She repeated the request 3 times. Each time her father stared through her as if she had turned invisible. Finally, he cleared his throat and passed over the salt shaker. Amy exchanged a look with Marissa, Jacob's wife. The rest of the dinner was a silent affair. Matt was driving down the highway when a huge surge of loneliness hit him. He got off at the next exit and stopped at the side of the road, tears springing from his eyes. He took out his phone and thought about calling someone. He scrolled down the contact list, seeing only one name he really wanted to call, but he didn't. Instead, he opened Twitter, tried to think of something witty or thoughtful to say, found nothing, and eventually retweeted a tweet from the oatmeal. For some reason, this made him feel better, and he got back on the road. Mitchell and Pauline were kissing, naked in bed. Pauline's hand snaked along the back of his leg, her fingers lightly touching his thigh, and suddenly he moved away.
"What's wrong?" she asked.
"Nothing," he said, unable to explain that her body suddenly reminded him of the dead body he had seen earlier, the remnants of the sports bra failing to cover the girl's decomposing flesh. He kissed her lightly on the lips, and she smiled, her eyes concerned. She fell asleep with Mitchell hugging her from behind, listening intently to her deep breaths, wondering if the dead girl had someone who missed her body, her warmth, her love. Annie, who had seen more death than any of the others, was mostly undisturbed. But there was a moment, just a tiny moment while she was in the shower, that a flashing memory of the girl's face invaded her thoughts. She brushed it aside, got out of the shower, dressed, and went to see a movie. On Monday morning, she autopsied the dead woman's body. She did it by herself, preferring the solitude. She didn't like using assistants for murder autopsies, though she couldn't say why. Once she was done, she called Jacob and informed him that she had some conclusions she wanted to share.
Chapter 2. To avoid any embarrassing moments in the morgue, Mitchell decided to smear some vapo-rub under his nostrils to mask the body's smell. As he stood by the metal gurney on which their Jane Doe lay, it occurred to him that vapo-rub was supposed to open up his nasal passageways even more, and that it might not have been the best idea he ever had. The smell was overpowering, and his stomach turned. He tried to push the feeling away and pay attention to what Annie was telling him and Jacob. She gestured at the body as she talked, the harsh white light in the morgue emphasizing the corpse's discolored skin. "The deceased was 21 years old," Annie said. "She was Caucasian, 5'7", red hair. It's difficult to determine exact weight, but she was quite thin. I can't really give you an accurate time of death yet. The ground at the burial site was moist, and summer temperatures fluctuate wildly. However, Matt extracted several larvae from her cavities and from the surrounding dirt, and we're consulting a forensic entomologist this afternoon. I think we'll be able to give you an approximate time of death this evening."
"Okay," Jacob said.
"The stomach and intestines were already liquefied when we uncovered the body, so I can't really tell you anything about their contents. However, I did find some interesting samples in the body's sinuses."
She walked over to a shelf, which held several jars, and picked one of them up to show them. "What is it?" Mitchell asked, squinting at the small patch of black matter.
"It's some sort of vegetation," Annie said.
"She inhaled it?" Jacob asked.
"So it appears," Annie said. "This could have happened for several reasons, but one of the most likely possibilities is drowning. Victims of drowning sometimes inhale aquatic vegetation when they are trying to breathe. She also had some sand particles in her mouth that didn't match the soil she was buried in, which I collected in the jar over there. She indicated a different container. But that doesn't tell us much, since she would have inhaled the particles if she was running during a windy day with some dust in the air. I also checked her bone marrow and found some diatoms there.
What's that? Mitchell asked.
I'm getting there, Annie said testily. Diatoms are one-celled phytoplankton that sometimes live in water. When people drown, they inhale these organisms, which later collect in the bone marrow.
But wouldn't a drowning victim have water in her lungs? Mitchell asked.
Not necessarily, Annie said. About 15% of drowning cases are dry drownings, which leave the lungs completely dry.
So she drowned? Jacob asked.
Well, Annie hesitated. The diatom test is not exactly conclusive, but it does indicate a likely possibility of drowning. Couple that with the plant I found in her sinuses, and we have high likelihood for drowning.
How high? Annie shrugged. Could the vegetation and the dust have come from the pond water in the park?
Absolutely, Annie said.
Can you check if they match?
I think so. I'll contact an expert I know.
Okay, Jacob said. A 21-year-old female who probably died from drowning. What else do you have for us?
I sent DNA samples to the lab to check in CODIS, Annie said. Unfortunately, I couldn't recover any fingerprints. I did find a root canal, which seems to be quite old, probably from childhood. If we do have a suspicion for a match, we can check against dental records.
Jacob and Mitchell both nodded. This was helpful, though they had hoped for more.
Anything else? Mitchell asked. I think she was abused as a child, Annie said.
What makes you say that? Jacob asked.
See here, Annie said, and walked toward one of the walls where some X-ray images hung. Two old fractures on the third left rib and one additional fracture on the fourth. Her left hand was broken twice, and there were several fractures in the fingers as well.
Maybe she was involved in some sort of accident, Mitchell suggested.
Annie shook her head. The fractures occurred at different times. No, this was a case of someone who for some reason got her bones broken over and over. I see this sometimes with people who do extreme sports, but these are really old fractures, so she had to be about 10 or 11 when some of them occurred, and this makes me doubt the extreme sports theory.
Okay, Jacob nodded.
Is there a way to know if she was sexually assaulted before she was killed? Mitchell asked.
Annie shook her head.
No way to know for sure, but I didn't find any traces to indicate she was, and her shorts and underwear were mostly intact.
Okay, Jacob nodded. Thanks, Annie.
So far, their Jane Doe remained anonymous.
As soon as they returned to the squad room, Mitchell made his way to the filing cabinet. He was not interested in anything inside. These days, almost all their files could be accessed digitally. But the file cabinet held the important position of pedestal for the coffee maker. He made a pot of strong black coffee and poured two cups, handing one to Jacob, who was already typing furiously on his keyboard. The coffee maker, a ridiculously expensive model bought a year before by Captain Fred Bailey, was the squad's most treasured possession. As far as Mitchell was concerned, it was more important than any of the detectives. He leaned against Jacob's desk, one of four desks in the room. The Glenmore Park Police Department had four detectives and a captain. They'd once had a lieutenant as well, but due to budget problems, the chief had decided they could do without, a decision that still inspired controversy and criticism.
Once you're done writing the report, send it over to me and I'll submit it to the system, Mitchell said.
Jacob sent him a look overcome with gratitude. His relationship with the department's internal report program was fraught with distrust and downright hatred. He sometimes reminded Mitchell of his mother, who called him regularly with complaints like, "The internet won't play the song I clicked on the desktop," or, "I wrote an email, but then the computer made it disappear, and now I can't find my pictures." Mitchell crossed the room to one of the whiteboards.
The room had two of them, used for brainstorm sessions or to collect info on major cases. Both were currently covered with doodles, mostly of ducks. He erased all of it, ducks included, and wrote at the top, "Jane Doe Murder, Buttermere Park." Then he headed to the captain's office to see if he was in and give him an update. The captain's office was adjacent to the squad room, separated by a rickety wooden door that was always on the verge of collapsing due to the captain's tendency to slam it when irritated. Mitchell knocked on the door several times, then went to sit by his computer. They could update Captain Bailey later. Mitchell opened NAMIS, the National Missing and Unidentified Persons System, on his computer. He searched for missing females in Massachusetts and received 5 results from the past year. 2 of those were aged 46 and 89. Mitchell ignored those and focused on the rest. Of the 3 left, 1 was African American, so he could ignore her as well. That left only 2. Their descriptions didn't exactly match the dead girls, but Mitchell had seen descriptions that ended up being wildly different from the actual person's appearance. He preferred to check for himself. He picked up the phone, then hesitated. After a second, he put down the phone, took out his mobile, and called Pauline instead. The call went unanswered, as it usually did. Pauline hardly ever answered calls during work, but he'd been hoping she'd answer anyway. It seemed as if they rarely had time together lately, with him working at all hours and her going to night classes in the evening and working during the day. He missed talking to her. The more he thought about it, the more he realized how much happier he was in those few minutes they managed to occasionally steal together. He was determined to try harder to find extra time to be with her, or at the very least, talk to her. A moment later, the inevitable message blinked on his phone screen. "Can't talk now, sorry." She almost never shortened any word while texting except "sorry" and "good night," which invariably turned to "sry" and "gnight." He sighed and put the phone back in his pocket, then picked up his office phone and called the number on the first missing female. A female voice answered the phone. "Hello?" "Hi," Mitchell said. "I'm Detective Lonnie from the Glenmore Park Police. Is this Mrs. Brody?"
"Yes, that's me."
"Mrs. Brody, I'm calling about your daughter, Patricia."
"Why?"
the woman asked.
"What happened to Patricia?"
"I understand you reported her missing 2 months ago."
"That's right."
"Well, we've had some recent developments, and we think that we may have new leads."
"My daughter returned 2 days after she went missing," the woman said.
"Oh." Mitchell drummed his fingers on the table. "Why didn't you inform us?"
"We didn't think about it."
"I see. When was the last time you saw your daughter?"
15 minutes ago. She went to her boyfriend's house."
"Aha. Okay, thanks, Mrs. Brody.
Next time, please, it's the same boyfriend she ran off with last time."
"Yes, I see. Well, next time, please let us know if he's up to no good, that one." "Thank you, Mrs. Brody," Mitchell said, and hung up. He called the second number. A gruff, impatient voice answered the call.
"This is Bob Verne."
"Hello, Mr. Verne. This is Detective Lonnie from the Glenmore Park Police Department. I understand that your daughter went missing 3 months ago." A moment's pause.
"Yeah?"
"Well, we've had some recent developments, and we wanted to check if they were relevant to your daughter's case."
"What kind of leads?"
The voice became soft, more urgent.
"Do you know where she is?"
"I would like to ask you some questions about your daughter."
"Go ahead."
"Her height, according to the missing persons report, is
5'6". She has red hair, kind of strawberry blonde, and green eyes, a scar behind her right knee. Do you know where she is?"
Annie hadn't mentioned a scar, and the Jane Doe's hair was a dark red, not even close to blonde. Still, Mitchell had to ask, "Did she have a root canal at some point?"
"No."
"You might not remember. It might have been when she was a small child. I'm a dentist, detective. I do all of my children's dental procedures."
"I see. I take it that the new developments are no longer relevant?"
"I'm sorry."
"I should have learned by now."
The man's voice became bitter. "I should never get my hopes up when you people call.
but I still do it every time. I'm really sorry, Mr. Verne. The man hung up. Missing persons is a dead end, Mitchell told Jacob.
Okay, then, Jacob said. We'll have to go with a car key.
Right, Mitchell said. If she lived near the park, she wouldn't have taken the car key with her. She probably parked her car in the vicinity.
Sounds likely, Jacob said, nodding. Since there was no apartment key on the body, or anything else for that matter, she probably left whatever she was carrying in the car and went for a jog.
Okay, then, Mitchell said, and opened a map of the city on his browser. Here's Buttermere Park. If she parked on the southern side, on Valley Vista Road, it would have been in one of those parking lots. He pointed at two parking lots on the map. There are no other parking spots on Vista Road.
Okay.
Jacob looked over Mitchell's shoulder. If she parked east of the park, she would have had to run through some unpleasant terrain to get there. So for now, let's assume her car's not there. But she could have parked anywhere on Firestone Drive. It's a quiet street, and there's lots of parking space there. If she did, and her car was left there for a week or more, it might have been towed.
Good point, Jacob said. Let's start with that.
He stood up and put on his hat. Where are you going? Mitchell asked.
To traffic, Jacob said.
The traffic division is inside the building, Mitchell pointed out. Why are you taking your hat?
It's my hat, Jacob said. He looked offended. It's part of my uniform. Do you go down to traffic without your pants?
Sometimes, Mitchell said, when I want them to take me seriously.
Okay, keep your pants on, please. I'll be right back. That report is waiting on my computer to be submitted.
When Jacob walked into the traffic division, it was empty except for Sergeant Wallace. Jacob had known Wallace for a very long time. They'd joined the force the same year and had been at the police academy together. Though they were on friendly terms, Jacob secretly thought Wallace was one of the most useless cops in the station. He'd been useless at the academy, always one step from being discharged, and he continued to be useless once he became a cop. During their academy days, their entire room disliked Wallace because he snored at night. Each snore was a long, ever-changing buzzing sound, rising high, then dropping low, only to suddenly stop completely. Anyone nearby would feel himself tense up, certain Wallace's breathing had finally stopped altogether and he was about to choke to death. Seconds would tick by, one, two, three, and then another buzzing snore would emerge from the man's twisted sinuses. It was a sound that was impossible to ignore, impossible to get used to, and it kept them awake at night when every second of sleep was precious. In the morning, when Wallace woke up, his bed was surrounded by shoes that had been lobbed at him during the night by his irate roommates. Wallace was a medium-sized man, a bit chubby, with tanned brown skin. He was balding. Unlike Jacob, however, he still had a crown of gray hair surrounding the bald spot on his head. His nose, despite the snoring, was quite wide and took up a large part of his face. As he saw Jacob, he smiled and leaned back. His belly made a brief appearance.
Cooper, he said, what brings you to our humble division?
Hey, Wallace, Jacob said. I'm trying to locate a car. It might have been towed from Firestone Drive sometime.
Okie dokie, Wallace said cheerfully. Do you have a description or license plate?
No.
Do you even know when it was towed?
I'm not even sure it was towed, Jacob said.
Well, that might make it difficult, Wallace sighed. I mean, there could have been dozens of cars towed from Firestone Drive in the past year. How will we be able to tell which one you're looking for?
That's my job, Jacob said.
It's just that if I had a more accurate description, I could save you some time.
I know, but I don't have a description.
Not even part of the license plate number? Maybe a witness saw some of the numbers. Sometimes people notice the strangest things. Did you ask the residents if they saw the car's license plates?
No, Wallace. No license plate.
Oh, a tricky one, huh? Doesn't make our life easier. Who knows how many cars were towed can you check?
Sure. Might be difficult, but I'll check. I mean, it would save us some time if you tried to find some details.
But let's see, maybe we can figure something out.
Wallace swiveled his chair to face his computer.
How's Melissa?
Marissa is fine, Jacob said. Doing great, actually.
Oh, glad to hear, glad to hear,
Wallace said, typing slowly with one finger. He was twice divorced and loved to tell anyone who cared to listen about his divorce woes.
A nice catch, that one.
Thanks, I think so, too.
Okay, there were no cars towed from Firestone Drive in the past 6 months.
None?
Nope.
Jacob was incredibly proud of himself for thanking Wallace politely. He returned to the squad room, dragged his chair to Mitchell's desk, and sat down. Mitchell was lost in thought, staring at the screen, and didn't turn to look at him. Mitchell always made Jacob feel a bit old. The young detective was 32, which was 24 years younger than Jacob. When Jacob had become a detective, Mitchell had been learning to draw with crayons instead of eat them. He was good-looking, too, as Jacob had repeatedly been told by his wife, his teenage daughter, and several co-workers. He was tall, wide-shouldered, skinny and muscular, his skin tawny. Unlike Jacob, he had hair, and it was infuriatingly rich and thick. And, of course, he had the Lonnie eyes, which all the Lonnie siblings were blessed with, jade green, deep, and perfect. Mitchell's eyes gave a constant impression of wisdom and sorrow, the eyes of an old soul, well acquainted with humanity's evil ways. Once, Mitchell had told Jacob this was no accident. He trimmed his eyebrows to make himself look more sorrowful. Jacob wouldn't have known how to trim his eyebrows even if his beloved wife's life depended on it. Then again, as Jacob had repeatedly proven, he could outdrink the young shrimp 3 pints to 1. He cleared his throat. No car towed from Firestone Drive in the past 6 months, he said. Okay, Mitchell said, turning to face him. Let's check the parking lots on Valley Vista Road. They got into their car and drove off. Traffic being what it was, it took them almost half an hour to get to the first parking lot on Valley Vista Road. There were 14 cars parked there. The key matched the fourth one they checked, a battered blue Chevrolet Cobalt. According to the registration, it belonged to Kendele Byers. Chapter 3. Kendele Byers' car had a small handbag in the trunk, and inside it, Jacob and Mitchell found a keychain with 2 keys and a wallet containing $57, a driver's license, and a credit card. They drove to the station, processed the car and its contents, and signed the keychain out. Kendele's address was registered as 76 Halifax Drive, which was an address in the Halifax Gardens Mobile Home Park, the city's only trailer park. Though it housed some of Glenmore Park's more impoverished citizens, Halifax Drive was a clean, quiet street. The trailers were small, beige-colored homes that hid their mobile infrastructure with white wooden bases. At first glance, they all looked the same. Same walls, same windows, same roofs. But on closer examination, the differences popped immediately. One was surrounded by circular pots containing various small trees. Another had custom-made red drapes on its windows. Most of them had tiny front yards, which ranged from immaculately tidy to jungle of death. Kendele's trailer was pretty much bare and looked as if it had just been bought and placed, except it was a bit dirtier than the trailers that surrounded it. The smell inside was slightly stuffy. It reminded Mitchell of the way his own apartment had smelled once after he had returned from a long vacation. The space was surprisingly roomy. The open-concept kitchen had a breakfast bar over which one could look out onto the living room. In the living room, a worn gray couch faced a small television set with a battered coffee table between them. The sink was mercifully empty. Mitchell had once entered the house of a woman who'd gone missing 2 months before. A few dirty plates had been left in the sink with some food leftovers. By the time the police had gotten there, the entire thing was infested by maggots and flies to the extent that it was hard to look at, not to mention the smell. There was a small black laptop on the coffee table. It was unplugged, and when Mitchell tried to turn it on, the screen remained dark. He located the laptop's cable under the table and plugged it in, then followed Jacob into the bedroom. Kendele seemed to have been quite orderly. Her clothes were hung neatly inside her closet, a small shabby dresser sitting underneath them. A red sweatshirt lay on the bed, and Mitchell guessed that she used to wear it at night when she went to sleep. He noticed her phone on the bedside table. Like the laptop, it was unplugged and dark. The charger lay on the same table. Mitchell plugged it in as well. He had a moment of unease, as he always did when he went through a dead person's things. What would Kendele have felt, knowing two strange men would be pawing through her meager belongings after she died, prying into her life? Mitchell doubted she'd like it. Jacob was checking the bathroom. He opened the small closet above the sink and scanned the interior. "Cymbalta," he said. "That's an antidepressant, right?" "Yeah," Mitchell said. "Several boxes here." Mitchell glanced inside. The bathroom was small and didn't really have room for both detectives to stand in it comfortably. Like the rest of the trailer, there was a layer of dust and dirt on everything, but in the white fluorescent light of the bathroom it was a lot more pronounced. He noticed a small laundry basket with some shirts, pants, and socks on top. Mitchell turned away. He wanted to check the phone and the laptop. If there was interesting information to be found, it would be on them. He made sure both were really charging, then went to the kitchen, where he methodically checked all the cupboards and drawers, but found nothing of note. He opened the fridge, and the situation there was not as horrid as it could have been. There were some rotting vegetables in the vegetable drawer, and a distinct smell of food gone bad, but it didn't look like this fridge had been abandoned for months. He glanced at the milk's expiration date, 3 weeks ago. When would Kendele have bought this? 5 weeks ago? He returned to the bedroom. Jacob was looking at the open closet, frowning. "What?" Mitchell asked.
"Pants," Jacob pointed. "Shirts, long-sleeved and short-sleeved. Some skirts, three dresses, sock drawer, another drawer with bras and two pairs of pantyhose. The shoes are on the bottom. See anything strange?"
It took Mitchell a few seconds. "No underpants," he finally said.
"Right."
Mitchell thought about the laundry basket. He went to the bathroom and emptied the basket on the floor. No underpants there, either. He returned to the bedroom.
"Weird," he said. "Maybe she went commando."
Jacob shook his head.
"No," he said. "She had underpants on when we found her. Annie told us so."
Mitchell tried to think. Would someone have taken the underpants away? But the closet didn't have an empty shelf, and the drawer with the bras seemed full. He looked around the bedroom for another place to hold them. "I think this bed opens up," he said. He went to one edge and lifted. The entire bed frame rose, revealing a small storage space. Inside were some boots, a couple of additional dresses, three handbags, and two big boxes. One was taped shut, the other was open. It was half full of underwear.
"That's interesting," Jacob said.
He got the open box out of the bed, put it on the floor, and sifted through the contents.
"There may be 100 pairs here," he said.
Mitchell started looking as well. The underwear were in all colors and all shapes. There were bikini briefs, G-strings, thongs, boy shorts, and even several that looked as if they belonged in someone's grandmother's closet. He got the second box and tore open the lid. More underpants. All of them were brand new.
"Who the hell needs so many underpants?" he asked.
Jacob shrugged.
"Maybe she had a weird phobia, didn't want to wear the same pair twice."
"Could be," Mitchell said. "I've never heard of anything like that."
"We learn something new every day."
Mitchell went over to the phone and turned it on. He waited patiently as the Android operating screen showed up. To his relief, the phone was unlocked. There was no email app on it, which he found unusual. He opened the last calls. Some incoming calls from unrecognized numbers, one call from someone named Leon, some calls from Debbie, two from Vernon. Last outgoing call was to Debbie 4.5 weeks ago. He checked the contact list, which was depressingly short. Kendele did not have a very active social life. He scanned the messages, several call me and why aren't you picking up call me messages from Debbie, a message from a tourist agency advertising a lake somewhere with an image depicting it, and three messages from someone selling a newspaper subscription. Finally, on July 20th, 4 weeks before, a conversation between Kendele and Leon, just random bits of information. Kendele asked him how he was, Leon said he was better. Kendele wrote that she would love to see him sometime soon. Leon wrote that he hoped to have some days off on Christmas. He called her Sis in one of his messages. Eventually, the messages ended with several increasingly worried messages asking Kendele why she wasn't answering her phone, and finally a message sent a week ago saying that if she didn't answer him right now, he'd call the police and report her missing. Mitchell wondered why he hadn't. Maybe because Leon knew she was actually dead and was just covering his tracks with those messages? Mitchell decided to check the phone more thoroughly once he returned to the office. He went back to the living room, where Jacob was checking one of the kitchen drawers. Mitchell had already checked them, but it wasn't like there was anything else to rummage through. "I have an outgoing message from her phone on July 20th," Mitchell said. "Okay. She was probably alive then." "Probably." Mitchell turned on the laptop. After several seconds, Windows came up. Once again, no password. There was a Thunderbird icon on the desktop, and he double-clicked it. "Whoa," he said. "What is it?" Jacob asked. "She wasn't leading a very exciting life according to her phone, but her inbox is bursting with incoming emails from dozens of different email addresses." Mitchell scanned them. "Most are almost certainly men," he added. He looked at the subjects. Some mentioned a package that hadn't arrived yet, or an order placed. There were several subjects which contained the word subscription. Two seemed incredibly desperate, all caps. One asked, "Where is my package?" And another said, "Please reply, I need some more." "I think she may have been a drug dealer," Mitchell said, scrolling down. He reached the red emails. Last email read was on July 20th.
"Why?"
Jacob asked.
"Just those email subjects. Hang on." He clicked one of them with the subject order details.
It was quite short.
"Hey, panty girl, I would like to order the following. 1, 2 blue G-strings, worn for a whole day. 2, 1 regular pair, worn at night, never mind the color, surprise me, wink face. 3, 1 regular pair, red, worn while running, at least twice. Please send it to the same address and send me the invoice. I think the order totals up to $210, right? Because last time I paid $40 extra for every run. Thanks, and have a lovely week." Mitchell glanced at Jacob, who was inspecting the window.
"She wasn't a drug dealer," he said. "She was selling her used underpants." Captain Fred Bailey was leaving work early. He was supposed to pick up his son from daycare, and this time he was determined not to be late. He didn't want to face the angry stare of the daycare teacher again, not to mention his son's disappointment and sadness. Sid had a knack for asking questions like, "Why did you pick me up after everyone left and I cried?" and "Why am I always the last to go home?" which made Fred feel bad for days, not anymore. He left his office through the squad room. Jacob and Mitchell were there, standing by one of the whiteboards. Fred paused behind them and cleared his throat. Both detectives turned around.
"Hey, Fred," Jacob said.
"How's the case going?"
Fred asked.
"The victim's name is Kendele Byers," Jacob said. "She lived in the trailer park. We came back from there about an hour ago. The trailer park manager said she moved in there in January."
"Moved in from where?"
"She didn't tell him. He said she was very quiet and kept to herself. First 3 months, she was late to pay the rent every month, and he almost kicked her out.
Then in April, she paid 4 months in advance. So she came into some cash, Fred said.
Well, Jacob said, she found a lucrative job. She was selling her used underwear online.
Seriously? Does that pay well?
According to what we can see from the PayPal invoices she started receiving, she was making about $150 a day, Mitchell said.
Huh, Fred said. Well, like my father used to say, there are all sorts of zebras in the herd.
Indeed, Jacob said, and pointed at the printed map they'd taped to the whiteboard. We found her car here. Last communication she had on her phone and her email account was on July 20th.
So we assume she died afterward, Fred said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.